Namaste.
Hello. Every time we breathe, something amazing is happening inside us. Tiny particles containing life are being transported to our vital organs. Not only that, each vital organ just receives enough energy so they could function healthily. Not too much, not too little. So we could keep the homeostasis or the equilibrium within us. And this beautiful process is made possible by our energetic system, which is comprised of three dominant elements: the bandhas, the energy locks, they regulate the flow of the energy; the nadis, they absorb the energy for our vital organs to utilize; and a central nervous system, which is responsible for our autonomic functions from waking up in the morning to sleeping at night. And this happens every time, all the time, as long as we breathe. And this is our gift, all right? The nadis are the channels of energy, yeah? And we have many thousands. They like sponge, so they absorb the energy out of the breath. And this energy, yeah, are being stored inside the nadis. So our vital organs can utilize them. The nadis could also store more energy. Yeah? So we utilize the energy as our buffer. So if we need more, you know, in times of sickness or illnesses, we can utilize our buffer of energy, you know, as we recover, you know, from our illness. So that's how important the nadis are. When the nadis break, we become ill. You know, when the nadis die, we die. And of the many thousands nadis we have in our system, three are the most dominant. Located at the right side is the Pingala Nadi, on the left is the Ida Nadi, and right through the very center is the Sushumna Nadi. There's no anatomical counterpart of the nadis, so even if we chop our bodies into many pieces, we won't be able to find them, but they exist. They manifest as sensations. And the Sushumna Nadi, the middle nadi, is the last channel to close, yeah, when we pass. So after this last breath, yeah, after the final drop of the energy exits the body, which is our soul or spirit, so it exits the endpoint of the Sushumna, higher up the Asa system. And once this last drop of the energy exits the body, the Sushumna Nadi closes and our mortal existence stops. So we can progress to the next stage. So that's the nadis. They cause us to live. You know, without them, we die. Blockages in the nadis makes us ill. All right. And then the bandhas are energy valves. All right. So they regulate the flow of the energy. So bandhas are commonly associated with organs or body parts or muscular movement like contraction, squeezing, but no. Bandhas are never about that. Bandhas are tools inside our bodies so we could harmonize and unify the flow of energy within us. So neither we're too energized or we're lacking the energy. So bandhas, they're like water tap. So turn the water faucet up and you allow more energy to flow, the water to flow, and then turn it down and then you limit the flow of the water, same inside our body. So bandhas, when the nervous system senses that we need more energy for a particular function, for a particular organ, so the bandhas, yeah, supply that particular organ with energy. For example, yeah, you're running, definitely you will be needing more energy, you know, to nourish the lungs. So the bandhas will pave way for the release of the energy, yeah, as dictated by the nervous system. All right, and we don't have to think about this. That's how beautifully designed, yeah, our bodies are. And this is a gift, yeah, this is our gift, all right? However, yeah, it's not always the case, all right? Our energetic system is always exposed to stresses and toxins, not just the physical, all right? Also, everything that we allow to enter our body, such as food or medication or even unhealthy sleeping patterns. For example, we lack enough rest or sleep, or we don't recover as we need to from an injury, and they all end up clogging the nadis, because the nadis are like sponges, so they absorb not just the energy, but they also absorb the toxins. So they really absorb anything flowing inside their bodies. So if, for example, we hurt ourselves, physical injury, emotional pain, or mental stress, even after we heal, the trauma gets stuck in our nadis. And this stagnation or blockages accumulate over time. All right. And once they accumulate, the energy won't be able to flow through them. Thus, we become ill. So blockages or stagnation in our nadis are the most common cause of our illnesses and diseases. All right. And of course, the wear and tear, as we age, the nadis weaken, and eventually they die, and we die as well. So our life depends on the health of our nadis. All right, the bandhas now, as I've mentioned, we have three primary bandhas. All right, so located down the bottom of the hips right here is the mula bandha. All right, so the mula bandha acts as the regulator of the energy which flows around the hips. All right, so the energy flowing around the hips, we call the apana vayu, is very potent, it's very rich, dense. It's made up of the element of fire and water. Yeah, and the hips are strong enough to withstand the pressure of the apana vayu. The apana vayu, we call the energy flowing down the hips. All right. So the mula bandha now will regulate the levels of the apana vayu to enter the shishumna nadi. The energy enters the middle channel, so it can move higher up the brain. So not all energy flowing in the hips are being directed to the Shishumna Nadi. Only its tiny components, gentle enough to allow the energy to lightly energize our nervous system. Too much of this fire could overheat our nervous system, could lead to damage of our neurons. So the Mula Bandha regulates the flow. The Mula Bandha narrows the pathway, so only a tiny amount of that force is being transported to the central nadi, the Shishumna Nadi. All right, and the energy flowing down the hips, are so dense and powerful that if, for example, we practice techniques which increase the flow of the energy there, and the bandhas are not efficient enough to regulate the levels of electricity we allow to enter our nervous system, this could cause serious issues in the future. For example, you're a beginner practitioner in yoga, then suddenly you expose yourself with advanced breath regulation. And this breath regulation exercises, some of them could be so intense that you might be able to awaken channels inside the body that in the first place should never be awakened yet. And here we are doing this advanced works, and this energy suddenly goes up, and this could hurt our nervous system. So the bandhas should be developed first, before us learning and practicing these advanced techniques of energy channeling. All right, so this is now where the program your teacher gives you will be very important, because the physical body would have to be developed first, because the bandhas awaken or they develop more than their normal function as the hips and the spine open up. So the asana, the physical postures we do in yoga, they're very helpful in strengthening the hips and making the spine open and sensitive. So the bandhas will be able to assist you further in channeling the energy. So that's the Mula Bandha, right? The Mula Bandha refines and regulates the force that we allow to enter our nervous system. All right. Now, but that force could still be quite intense. So another bandha would refine it further. It will filter it down more, And this bandha is the second bandha located, you know, below the two big ribs, right through the very middle. We call that the Uddiyana bandha. Uddiyana bandha means to fly. It's also referred to as the flying up block because it makes the body so light, the practice of asana and breath regulation. It's the most dominant of all bandhas. It gives us that core stability, so to speak. Right. But energetically, the Uddiyana bandha further filters down the energy coming from the hips. So the Mula bandha, you know, refines it. The Uddiyana bandha further, you know, refines it, so only the gentle form is allowed to flow through our thoracic cavity, where the vital and sensitive organs of the heart and the lungs are located. All right, so that's how vital the bandhas are. So they're not about squeezing, tightening, clenching. They regulate the flow of the energy, so they harmonize the flow of the energy, so they become our inner energetic support. So when we channel the energy, we do not hurt our vital organs, because the chest region, yeah, the lungs and the heart are quite sensitive, so we don't want to be overloading that system. That is why there are breath regulations in yoga which are contraindicated for people who have cardiorespiratory conditions. For example, you have weak heart, yeah, you don't practice, or progressively you have to learn and be careful when you practice the Ujjayi breath, the victorious breath. Why is that so? Because in the victorious breath, the Ujjayi breath, what you are doing is actually opening the Uddiyana bandha a little bit wide, so the fire of the apana or the kundalini could enter the chest region. All right, and at the same time, the Ujjayi breath, you narrow the pathway of the backs of the throat, so the prana coming from the outside, which is cooler than the apana, yeah, is also minimized. So you can blend the force of the prana and the apana vayu inside the chest region. And then people with heart conditions, yeah, this technique might be too intense for their cardiorespiratory system, because the energy that we allow to blend the thoracic region when we practice the Ujjayi breath could be, you know, too intense for your heart, right? But over time, through the guidance of the teacher, you will be able to rise above the limitations. So Ujjayi breath could be learned, you know, progressively, bit by bit, until such time that your cardiorespiratory system is strong enough to withstand the pressure of the energy. All right. Now, further up the astral system, so we have another lock located between the collarbones, right at the very middle. We call the Jalandhara bandha. Jalandhara means to pull up, to rise. Yeah. It also means at the top, like the mountain, or at the peak of the mountain. So the Jalandhara bandha further, yeah, refines the energy. Actually, the Jalandhara bandha performs two sensitive energetic actions. The first being, it filters the energy coming from the bottom regions of the body, so only its absolute form is allowed to enter the inner brain. All right, and it filters as well the energy coming from the outside, the prana, so only a subtle force of it is allowed to enter the inner body, so we don't overpower the inner system. Because in energy channeling, we have to blend just enough levels of the energies we combine inside the body, so we could, you know, allow the energy to assume a character, or a level of electricity, just enough, you know, to stimulate the inner brain. Too much of the energy could burn, you know, the delicate soma inside the inner brain, which would cause the, or render the practice of meditation useless, because your mind will be too energized. Too little, yeah, it won't happen, you know, because you need something there inside, higher than what it can normally process, so you can create that spark inside. Because when you do the meditation, what we're trying to do there is to allow a little bit electricity higher than it can normally, you know, handle in a regular situation, to stimulate the inner brain, really higher up the top of the spine, where the pineal gland, the pituitary glands are located. And when this tiny level of electricity is allowed to stimulate the inner brain, it causes electrical reaction leading to energy absorption. All right, so you further stimulate the inner brain, but not too much, to the point that you burn the soma. So meditation is like we're a chemist. So you're blending forces. So you want just that enough, blending of the energy to create that absorption, healthy for your nervous system. All right, so in a nutshell, that's how the energy works. All right, but in a normal situation, this happens all the time, every time, to allow the normal functions of the nervous system to happen healthily. All right, but again, it's not always the case, as I mentioned, because we always subject and expose our bodies to stresses. So even this, mental stress definitely could hurt the nadis. And then over time of us being exposed to toxins, unhealthy lifestyle, unhealthy eating habits, rest, and even the mental stress from work or school, home, or even our emotional heaviness could hurt our vital organs. So how do we now, keep the balance, which is more important, so we can keep the health of our nadis? All right, so we need to practice a combination of physical strengthening. So if you practice the yoga asanas, continue doing that. All right. Breath regulation or awareness of the breath. You don't have to do advanced breath regulation exercises for general health and wellness. There is only one that I really want you to grow and practice and keep. It's the Nadi Shodhana. I've given so many tutorials about the Nadi Shodhana. You may want to take a look at those lessons so you can appreciate the technique. The Nadi Shodhana for me is the most healing of all. There's no contraindication. Everyone could practice the Nadi Shodhana. You don't have to do the retention. Just breathe in through the left channel. Close the left channel. Exhale through the right channel. Inhale through the right. And exhale, and then do this every day. 5 minutes will do wonders for your health. Nadi Shodhana means purification of our nadis. So by doing this, we release stagnation of our energetic channels. And at the same time, mentally, it's quite relaxing. It relaxes the nervous system. It releases mental stress. So it has this immediate effect to the nervous system, the Nadi Shodhana. And everyone can practice this. And then progressively, as your vital organs and your body become stronger, then you can advance the practice to learn and do the retention or the kumbhakas. And the kumbhakas are quite manageable too, because you don't have to really hold the retention for a long time, maybe just 2 seconds, inhaling and holding, 2, 1, exhaling. You don't have to do the retention at the exhalation. Inhale again and retain until you're able to lightly hold, maybe 8 seconds at the top of the inhalation. And as you hold the prana inside during the puraha kumbhaka inhale retention, your nadis are able to absorb more energy out of the breath. And then you're using the bandhas inside now, and your bandhas will essentially manifests as a byproduct of you strengthening the body and then opening the inner pathways. Your bandhas now will be able to help you in irrigating or cleansing the nadis. So the nadis are like channels or tubes inside, and the three main ones are like canals. So as you breathe through it, so you use the breath and the bandhas to pierce and brush through the walls of the nadis so you can continue cleansing them, and you exhale the heaviness out of your system. All right, so that's the energetic system. So it's a beautiful creation. The miracle. We call life. So within us is the creation. The divine. Presence of God as a universal entity, not commonly we know, God, but something which is very nourishing, something which is encompassing for everyone. So it doesn't discriminate, discriminate who you are, where you are. So it's readily available, and this is always present when we breathe. When we breathe mindfully and consciously, we allow the nervous system to get involved in the process of our autonomic functions, then we gain access to the higher functions of the breath. And once this happens, we feel the presence of God within the breath. All right, so it's really good to understand this from that perspective. So we become less attached to, for example, the clinging, the power of the physical body. So we become more attuned to the subtleness of our energies. All right, and at the end of it, these three primary bandhas work as one. So they become just one, and we call this the Mahabandha, or the Great Seal. So the Mahabandha is when the bandhas perform a function inside in even levels, intensities. Right? So the Mahabandha is when the energetic system is so open that the bandhas now can just relax, and they can work in level, in even intensities. But definitely the spine would have to remain open. But it's not about clenching and squeezing and tightening as we commonly see it. Mahabandha is an organic experience. It happens when the physical body is relaxed. When the physical body is relaxed, the autonomic functions slightly backs off and the energetic system takes over. Right. And the Mahabandha, for me, its true meaning is when we can access it when the body is relaxed. Even lying down in the Shavasana, Mahabandha could happen. Whether you're sitting, Mahabandha could happen. Or during conscious sleep, yoga nidra, when we meditate. All right. When this happens, the energy freely flows through our nadis, no obstruction at all. And your mind witnesses everything that happens as you meditate within you and outside you. All right. So I hope you enjoyed this lesson. I hope I'm able to help you understand the jargons and the terminologies of the bandhas and the yogas and the energetic system. Because if you're studying yoga, this could be daunting. Too much terminologies. And I hope I'm able to explain that to you in simple terms. And if you are feeling this already, celebrate your effort. Appreciate your hard work. It's no easy task developing the inner body. See you in the next lesson. Have a meaningful day. Namaste.